The Holy Gospel, as it is recorded in Matthew. This is the family record of Jesus the Christ, descendant of David, descendant of Abraham. Abraham begot Isaac, Isaac begot Jacob, Jacob begot Judah and his sisters and brothers. Tamar and Judah begot Perez and Zerah. Perez begot Hezron. Hezron begot Ram. Ram begot Amminadab. Amminadab begot Nahshon. Nahshon begot Solomon. Nahshon begot Solomon. Rahab and Solomon begot Boaz. Ruth and Boaz begot Obed. Obed begot Jesse, and Jesse begot David, the ruler. Bathsheba, who had been the wife of Uriah, and David begot Solomon. Solomon begot Rehoboam. Rehoboam begot Abijah. Abijah begot Asa. Asa begot Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat begot Joram. Joram begot Uzziah. Uzziah begot Jotham. Jotham begot Ahaz. Ahaz begot Hezekiah. Hezekiah begot Manasseh. Manasseh begot Amon. Amon begot Josiah. Josiah begot Jeconiah, and his sisters and brothers at the time of the Babylonian captivity. After the Babylonian captivity, Jeconiah begot Shealtiel. Shealtiel begot Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel begot Abiud. Abiud begot Eliakim. Eliakim begot Azor. Azor begot Zadok. And Zadok begot Ahim. Ahim begot Elihud. Elihud begot Eleazar. Eleazar begot Matan. Matan begot Jacob. Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary. And from her, Jesus was born. Thus, there were 14 generations from Abraham to David, 14 generations from David to the Babylonian captivity, and 14 generations from the Babylonian captivity to the Messiah. This is the gospel of Christ. Please be seated. I need... Wow, that was a whole lot of beginning to get through. 14 generations plus 14 generations plus 14 generations makes 42 generations. And most of us know from our reading of the Hebrew Scriptures that there were more than 42 generations. A whole lot of people got left out. Now, you might just think that the anonymous gospel storyteller that we call Matthew has provided for us here a genealogy of Jesus. But I really don't think so. If these first 17 verses are anything to go by, the storyteller either doesn't care much about providing an accurate record, or he is simply a really poor genealogist. The stories in the Hebrew Scriptures provide us with the names from generations that our storyteller leaves out, and either Matthew missed them by mistake, or Matthew didn't see the value of recording those particular names. I suspect that these 17 verses are something far more significant than a mere genealogy. I suspect that these 17 verses are in and of themselves a parable. A parable is a story which communicates meaning. I believe that the first 17 verses of the Gospel according to Matthew is but the first of a series of parables which the storyteller uses to communicate the meaning of Jesus' birth. Now, interestingly enough, the two scholars that I got this idea from, Dominic Crossan and Marcus Borg, they limit this parabolic storytelling to the nativity pieces, one in Matthew and one in Luke, and totally ignore the first 17 verses. But I think these 17 verses are also a parable. If we look closely, you can see the skillful way in which the storyteller prepares us for the scandal of Jesus' birth. Quite unusually, this ancient genealogy contains the names of five women. Now, there were lots and lots of women in the course of those 42 generations that the storyteller could have mentioned. But the anonymous gospel storyteller, who we call Matthew, chose to mention only five women. Five very particular women. The first of the forefathers mentioned is, not surprisingly, Abraham. And our storyteller could have mentioned Abraham's wife, Sarah, but instead chose to ignore Sarah and tell us instead about Isaac, Jacob, and Judah before mentioning the first of the four mothers. Our storyteller never mentions Sarah or Rebecca or Rachel or Sheila before he offers up Tamar for our consideration. Our storyteller declines to mention several more of Jesus' four mothers before offering us Jesus' four mother, Rahab. And you guessed it, our storyteller fails to mention other four mothers before offering us Ruth and then Bathsheba. What meaning is our storyteller trying to convey with this parable designed to prepare us for the story of Jesus' birth? Like all good parables, we must delve deeply into the stories behind the story to discover the power of the parable to transform our understanding of the meaning of Jesus' birth.
Sight. So Yahweh caused Er's death. Then Judah told Onan, "You must sleep with your brother's wife to fulfill the duty of a brother-in-law to her. You must raise the offspring of your brother." Onan knew the offspring would not be his, so whenever he would lie with her, he would ejaculate on the ground to avoid begetting an offspring for his dead brother. But what Onan did was bad in Yahweh's sight. So Yahweh took away Onan's life, too.
That's all right. So, have you ever heard that verse in church before?
No.
Never heard it in church? Read on a Sunday morning? Interestingly enough, that particular verse is the justification for the church's, for generations, preaching against masturbation. That's where it comes from. It was called Onanism. Imagine going down in history with that. The mention of the name Tamar to a Jewish audience at the end of the first century would have had the effect I believe our storyteller was after. It would have been jarring. Tamar is a widow who must sleep with her dead husband's brother in order to produce a male heir. Tamar is widowed again when her brother-in-law refuses to play along and dumps a seed on the floor so that Tamar will not become pregnant. The story is rarely told. But wait, the mention of the name Tamar would lead us to another story that's even worse, that I bet you've never heard in church before. After losing both her husbands to the wrath of Yahweh, poor Yahweh gets blamed for a great deal in these stories. Anyway, Tamar finds herself a widow twice over. And according to the story, Tamar makes what is described as a shameful exit and goes back to her father's home and tries to pick up the pieces of her life. Now, in the meantime, her father-in-law, Judah's wife, dies, and he too becomes a widow. And lo and behold, in the course of events, Judah has some business to conduct in the village where his daughter-in-law is now living. And when Tamar learns that Judah is coming, she decides to set a trap for him. According to the story, and it's very, very detailed, Tamar dresses up like a prostitute. And she goes out and she sits at the gate of the city where all the other women ply their trade. Aye, aye, wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Out by the gate of the city, Tamar struts her wares, and old Judah comes along and likes what he sees and decides to strike up a bargain with Tamar. No idea who his daughter-in-law is. Doesn't expect to meet his daughter-in-law. And so, for the price of a kid, a goat that is, Judah makes a deal with a woman he believes to be a prostitute. Trouble is, Judah doesn't have a kid with him. So as collateral, Judah offers his signet ring together with the rope with which he girds his loins and another piece of clothing. And Tamar holds on to these precious items. And Judah has relations with Tamar and then goes about his business in the town. And after he returns home, he sends a servant to deliver the kid to the prostitute. And the servant can't find the prostitute. And furthermore, the people of the town insist, there are no prostitutes in our town. Judah, a man who pays his debts, also searches unsuccessfully for the woman. And time passes, and Judah hears a rumor that his daughter-in-law is now pregnant. And he is, as the story goes, filled with wrath. Imagine, pregnant, not married, and pregnant. She's acted unfaithfully. She's an adulteress. And so, as the head of the family, Judah takes steps to have Tamar executed. And Tamar is dragged out to be burnt at the stake. And just before the fires are lit, Tamar says, "Oh, by the way, that person by whom I am expecting this child is the owner of this ring and this rope and this piece of clothing." Judah recognizes the items as his own, and he publicly repents. And Judah takes Tamar into his harem, and she produces twins, and one of them is named Perez, who, as our gospel storyteller lists, is one of Jesus' forefathers. Jesus' lineage is traced back to the incestuous relationship of a father-in-law with his daughter-in-law, whom he purchased for sex. Jesus' lineage is traced back to a sex worker. What do you suppose the gospel storyteller is trying to communicate?
As the darkness. A reading from the book of Joshua. Then Joshua ben Nun secretly sent out two spies from Shittim, ordering them, "Go, scout out the territory, especially Jericho." The two spies set off and went to Jericho. There they went to the house of a prostitute named Rahab, where they spent the night. When the word reached the ruler of Jericho that two Israelites had arrived that evening to scout the territory, the ruler sent this message to Rahab: "Bring me the two who are lodging in your house, for they are there here to spy on my land." But Rahab took the two spies and hid them, then told the ruler, "Yes, they did come here, but I did not know where they were from." And after dark, knowing that the gate would be closed soon, they left. I do not know where they went, but as soon as the posse had left, they shut the gate.
Rahab, some of you may remember her from Sunday school days. The story of the Battle of Jericho begins with the story of Rahab. Now, this translation referred to her as a prostitute. Older translations call her a harlot. She was actually an innkeeper at a house of ill repute, a madam of sorts. She lived in the red light district of Jericho, and when Joshua sent his spies across the Jordan into Jericho, Rahab entertained them. The spies would have been caught if Rahab had not helped them to escape. The spies promised that when Joshua's army moved into Jericho, they would protect Rahab because of her services to them. And Rahab was instructed to hang a red cloth, a red ribbon of sorts, in her window so Joshua's army would know not to kill anyone in that house. Rahab planned to bring all of her family into her home so that they would all be spared. And everything goes according to plan, and according to the story, Rahab marries one of her Jewish conquerors. Jesus' lineage is traced back to a collaborator, a woman of ill repute, a madam, if you will. What do you suppose the gospel storyteller is trying to communicate about the birth of Jesus?
Fulfillment and make sure you are provided for. And Boaz, whose workers you have been following, is our closest relative. Tonight he will be winnowing grain on the threshing floor. Wash up and put on perfume and dress in your finest clothes. Then go down to the threshing floor. But do not let him know you are there until he has finished eating and drinking. When he goes to sleep, watch to see where he lies down. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down with him. He will tell you what to do next.
Ruth, most of us hear about Ruth and her mother-in-law, Naomi, most often at weddings. Where you go, I will go, your people shall be my people. But very few people ever read the third chapter of the book of Ruth. It doesn't appear in any of our lectionaries. Ruth was a Moabite girl, married to a Jewish man, Naomi's son. And in the course of the story, Naomi's husband and her two sons die. And this family consists of a Jewish mother and two Moabite daughter-in-laws. These women are vulnerable, without any male protectors. And so one of the Moabite daughters returns to his father's house, but not Ruth. Ruth clings to Naomi. And together they move back to Naomi's homeland in Israel. And Ruth takes care of Naomi. But even in Israel, the two widows are vulnerable. And according to the law, widows are to be protected and cared for. And so there's always great attempts to move them into someone's household for protection. But these two women have no one to take them into their care. And there's this proviso in the law for widows who have no males to protect them. And also for the poor. According to Jewish law, a portion of the crop in the field is to be left so that the poor can glean enough to eat. And so each day Ruth goes out into the fields to glean enough grain to keep herself and Naomi alive. And eventually Naomi realizes that the man who owns these particular fields where Ruth has been gleaning grain is a distant relative of her dead husband. The man's name is Boaz. And according to the law, Boaz could exercise his right to marry the widow of a kinsman. Together, Naomi and Ruth, they hatch a scheme to seduce Boaz. In chapter 3, the chapter nobody reads in church, it says that Ruth went down to the river and bathed herself until she was, and I quote, wondrously clean. And she put on her best dress, and she put on all the perfume that she had. And she planned to go to the harvest celebration, and she planned to seduce Boaz as the wine at these harvest festivals flows freely. True to plan, Boaz drank so much that he fell asleep. Now, in an old Hollywood movie, those old black and white movies, this is the part where they would fade to black. Ruth has got some fairly specific instructions from her mother-in-law about how to go about this particular seduction. So picture Boaz stretched out in some outbuilding, snoring away. Naomi says very specifically to her daughter-in-law, uncover his feet. Sounds harmless enough, doesn't it? Uncover his feet. Except, in ancient Hebrew, feet is a euphemism for a different part of the male anatomy. Ruth does as her mother-in-law instructs. She uncovers Boaz. And I'm going to fade to black. Jesus' lineage is traced back to a seductress. What do you suppose our gospel storyteller is trying to communicate about the birth of Jesus?
Yeah. A reading from the second book of Samuel. In the spring, that time of the year when rulers go off to war, David sent Joab out along with his officers and troops. They massacred the Ammonites and laid siege to Rabbah. David, however, stayed in Jerusalem. As evening approached, David rose from his couch and strolled about on the flat roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman, a very beautiful woman, bathing. David made inquiries about her and learned that her name was Bathsheba, and that she was the daughter of Eliam and the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Then David sent messengers to fetch her. She came to him, and he slept with her, at a time when she had been declared ritually clean after her monthly period. Then she returned to her house, but she conceived and sent this message to David, "I am pregnant."
I don't know about you, but that Alleluia song, the Leonard Cohen thing, he saw her bathing on the roof. Makes it sound so innocent, right? He saw her bathing on the roof. King David lived in a palace that was the biggest house in all of Jerusalem. And he goes out onto his rooftop and he surveys the entire kingdom. And he's able to look down on the rooftops of the other houses in Jerusalem. And below him, on one of those rooftops, was an exquisitely beautiful woman taking a bath. And that sounds unusual for us. What's a woman doing on a rooftop taking a bath? That's where the water was, so that it would flow down into the house. Taking a bath in ancient Israel on a rooftop was a common occurrence for people of a particular class. Because her husband was an officer in David's army, she was sort of upper middle class. She could have afforded a bathtub on her roof. And so David sees this beautiful woman doing something absolutely normal, having a bath on her rooftop. And what does he do? Doesn't look away. Leave her privacy. He watched her. And he watched her. King David was a peeping Tom. A peeping Tom who is so smitten with this beautiful young woman that he uses the power of his office to summon her. Bathsheba has no possibility of saying no to the king. She must go. One thing leads to another, and adultery ensues, but it doesn't end there. Bathsheba becomes pregnant, and through various machinations, King David engineers the death of Bathsheba's husband, Uriah. David murders her husband. When Uriah is killed, David adds Bathsheba to his harem. She becomes one of many, a favorite one, but one of many. This is the story of adultery and murder. Jesus' lineage is traced back to a woman who participates in adultery and murder, or who may be the victim. We don't know. What do you suppose our gospel storyteller is trying to communicate about the birth of Jesus? The stories of Jesus' foremothers read like a soap opera. What is the gospel storyteller that we call Matthew trying to communicate about the meaning of Jesus' birth? anonymous gospel storyteller that we call Matthew ends this parable with these words. Thus, there were 14 generations from Abraham to David, 14 generations from David to Babylon, to the Babylonian captivity, and 14 generations from the Babylonian captivity to the Messiah. The Messiah who was to be born of Mary. Through the four foremothers, the gospel storyteller brings us to the mother in whom the hope of the world is gestating. Our storyteller didn't have to mention the four foremothers. He could have avoided the scandalous stories that their names conjured up in the minds of his audiences. But Matthew insists, and so the foremothers of Mary are lined up to communicate to all who hear or read this parabolic overture something of the truth about the nature of divinity. Every family shares similar stories. Life is complicated, life is messy, sex and violence, sex and exploitation, sex and vulnerability. What resolution, what hope does our storyteller offer us out of all this begetting? A young woman who is vulnerable, exploited, and in danger of becoming the victim of violence. More of the same, something ordinary, and yet therein lies the hope of the world. In the ordinary stuff of life, in the mess of life, there is hope. The Divine One emerges in the midst of the vulnerable, the exploited, the endangered, the immoral, and the survivors of the worst that life can dish out. The Divine One is born again and again and again. And therein lies the hope of the world. Love is born over and over, again and again, in the likes of you and in the likes of me. Love gestates within. Let each of us prepare to give birth to love.